So we're going to actually start with a sort of quick history of what it means to rediscover the ancient Near East. And I always put this in quotation marks. The study of ancient Persia or ancient Iran was something that was a sort of surprising discovery to European and North American scholars when they went off to the Middle East. And we say rediscovery in quotations because, of course, in the Middle East, nobody had lost this history. But in the 1800s, a lot of European scholars, then American scholars, went off to the Middle East, largely looking to be able to prove the Old Testament was true. And so we have a series of excavations and explorations, and these are just some of them starting in the 1830s. But the ones I really want to draw your attention to here are 835 to 1844, when a British scholar named Rawlinson was able to decipher the Behistun inscription, which is a very famous inscription from the very first Persian Empire. And it set off and it set in motion a lot of interest in Persian empires. We then got excavations all the way through. And then by the early 20th century, we had excavations at the major Persian center. Since then, scholars have explored these regions more, but it was really in the 1800s that this started to appear. And the major discovery came with the deciphering of what is known as the Behistun inscription. And I'll place this in historical context later on. But what was really key about this is a Persian inscription that was carved high up on a rock face. And there's a drawing from the original book, and there's a photograph, and then that's what it looks like. Overshadowing the trade routes in Persia, it was a royal inscription. It was carved in three languages. It was carved in Elamite, Akkadian, and Old Persian. And in all three of these, it was done in cuneiform. Now, to that point, we hadn't been able to decipher cuneiform, but because Old Persian is close to modern Farsi, they were able to crack the code and it helped to break into cuneiform. And that started off general studies in this period. We're still trying to figure out Elamite. It's another language that was spoken by the people in Iran before the Persians. But this was this first Persian site was really something that set off all sorts of other Near Eastern studies. But we still in the West don't really understand the three major Persian empires. So when we teach this stuff in classics, we always teach it in relation to the Greeks and in relation to the Romans. And I'm not going to do that tonight. I'm going to just talk to you about who these three major empires were. All three are long-lived and important groups. They have massive empires with their own important internal discussions and populations. And yet, because we have focused on the West, we've left out the discussion of these. And I think it's a bit of a shame because, well, it's more than a bit of a shame because there are elements of these Persian empires that are significant for us in understanding modern, modern context in the Middle East. So we'll start with the very first of these. So this is most properly known as the Achaemenid or the Achaemenid Empire. Depending on where you're from, you may also pronounce it Achaemenid. So it is an empire that lasted from about 559 to 330. And one of the difficulties we have with understanding the history of these is, unlike other empires like the Roman Empire, they don't leave for us a vast number of written sources. And so because up until this century, we've been more excited by written sources than by archaeology, a lot of this has been forgotten. But now that we understand more about the archaeology, we understand more how significant these empires were. So the first of these, if you are familiar with the Old Testament, you will recognize these Persians from the Old Testament. If you've seen the terrible film 300, you will recognize these Persians from there, vaguely. I have nothing good to say about that movie. But these are the first Persians. These are the ones that the Greeks encountered. And you can see from the map here that this is an empire that starts here in Fars province in Iran, and by at its height extends into what we would think of as Afghanistan and northern India, up to the Caspian Sea, all the way over to the coast of Turkey today and into Egypt and Libya. Now, they don't control this area for the entirety, and I'll show you how it develops, but they are, this is a massive, massive empire with a very long lifespan. Now, our sources for the Persians, which is the name that the Greeks and the Romans gave them, is pretty complicated. So we have some Greek sources, and most famously, Herodotus tells us the story of Marathon, and he tells us all about the customs of the Persians as he understands them. He gets them wrong. Most of the time, I'm pretty sure Herodotus, you know, got them in a bar somewhere. Yeah, let me tell you about the Persians. We don't think he ever visited Persia, but for a long time, we sort of believed him. Thucydides talks about the aftermath after the battles. And a really interesting source is Xenophon, who in fact worked as a mercenary for the Persians and wrote a lengthy history of trying to get back to Greece called the Anabasis. We also have references to these Persians in particularly the books of Daniel and Ezra. And for Persian sources, we are left with some coins, a lot of architecture, some inscriptions, and some papyri, mostly from Egypt. And I'll show you how that works in a second. So who were they? So the first thing we can say about these Persians is that they appear to have arrived in the area we would consider modern Iran sometime in probably the 7th century, maybe a little bit earlier. We don't know much about their origins. They seem to have come from what we would think of as northern India today. And Farsi or modern Persian, old Persian, middle Persian, it's very different from the other languages in the Middle East because it's an Indo-European language with connections to Sanskrit. So it's a very early Indo-European language that appears in the Middle East around the 7th century. Now, when they first arrive, they write it in cuneiform, which is the ancient script of the Middle East. And it's a script, not a language, so you can use it to write all sorts of different languages. Our first real evidence for them is this, which is a seal, which has the name Cyrus, king of Anshan, which was another name for this region. And he seems to have been a local king between 620 and 590. But we know he's arrived from somewhere else, or his people have, and they have started to push out the people who were indigenous in Iran. So how do we know this? Archaeologically, there's a slow abandonment of early sites. There's a bunch of them listed here if you're interested. They take control of the region. And then we start to see them appearing in stories by the Greeks. So Herodotus tells us the story of Cyrus defeating Astyages of the Medes, then Croesus of Lydia, and you see Croesus here on a Greek pot. And then they defeat, they take Babylonia, and there's the defeat of the Babylonians at the Battle of Opus. And so we generally say that the accepted dates for this empire are 559 to 530. Within 30 years, they control everything from the Jaxartes to the Mediterranean, except Egypt, which they get in fairly short order. So the dates are a little bit fudged because we don't have written sources from them. So the problem for a lot of, for archaeologists and for people working on this is this was an empire that arrives with a completely new language that nobody else in the region speaks. And so very quickly, they realize that that's not going to be the way to communicate. And so we do have some inscriptions in Old Persian. We have some where they use Elamite, which is the language that was spoken before. But for the most part, they choose to use the ancient language of Aramaic because it is a language that is spoken all the way to Egypt. And so most of our sources for these guys actually come in a language that wasn't their own language. And this is actually really very clear in the Old Testament, where both the books of Ezra and Daniel have huge chunks written in Aramaic. So literally in the middle of a chapter, it stops being in Hebrew and starts being in Aramaic. In Ezra, this is probably because the records go back to this period. In Daniel, it's probably a literary conceit because it's quite a late text. But the point is that they understood that that was the language that the Persians were using. So Cyrus the Great is Cyrus II, and we know of him mostly from his conquest of the city of Babylon. And what you're looking at here is probably the most famous Persian artifact, and it's in the British Museum today. And this is known as the Cyrus Cylinder. And the Cyrus Cylinder is probably one of the funnest artifacts from the ancient world. Because Cyrus had basically made a deal with all of the priests in Babylon to take over Babylon from the Neo-Babylonians in a relatively peaceful way because they were disgruntled with their former leader. And so he makes the backroom deal and they kind of let the Persian Empire in. And when they take over Babylon and they take over Babylonia, we actually have a pretty good sense of how they're going to rule as an empire, because they don't really rule by conquest or by forcing religious beliefs on populations. They do rule in a sort of diplomatic fashion. So we have this cylinder, which is quite a big object. It's a big thing. And it tells the story of how, you know, Cyrus was minding his own business and the gods from Babylonia came to him and said, you know, we really need you. And so if you actually read the text from the Cyrus cylinder, it's all about how Marduk, the god of Babylon, has asked Cyrus to come in and clean house. Now, what's fun about this is that Cyrus didn't believe in Marduk. They have their own religion, which I'll talk about in a second. And so he's very good at using propaganda to get what he wants. But it sets the stage for how they're going to run things. So very soon after Cyrus takes over, the Jews who were settled in Babylon come to him and they say, the very devout Jewish community comes and they say, well, we would really like to go back to Jerusalem and rebuild the temple. And Cyrus says, sure. And here's some money. Off you go. And so because he knows that then the population will support them, he actually supports all of these local populations. And so he gets really good press in the Old Testament because they were seen as supportive of the Jews. Now, at the same time, a large Jewish community remains in Babylon, and that will become important later on in this talk. But what we see is an empire that actually rules, except when it comes to the Greeks, through a lot of diplomacy. So what are the characteristics of this empire? So first of all, they use Aramaic as their lingua franca. So we have Aramaic documents all over the empire. And the picture I have put up here is actually a really significant one. This comes from a tiny island in the very south of Egypt called Elephantine or Philae. And this is an Aramaic document written by a Jewish mercenary group who had been sent by the Persians to guard that border. And there's a large group of these Jewish mercenaries. They're taking local wives And they get it into their heads that either their place of worship, and we're not sure what it was destroyed. And so they get it into their heads that they're going to rebuild a temple. And yes, like the temple in Jerusalem in southern Egypt. And so they write to the Persian governor and ask for permission to do this. So there's all sorts of interesting things tied up in there. First of all, this is antithetical to everything we think we know about the development of Judaism. But second, how interesting that a group of Jewish mercenaries go to a Persian governor to ask for permission to build a religious structure, right? And we have a huge collection of these from southern Egypt that cover everything from marriage contracts to Passover rules. And so really important that tell us how different communities were interacting with the Persian kings and governors. So they rule through both diplomacy and military might. They rule through a system of provinces, which are known as satrapies, and they're run by governors who are known as satraps. And they have an extensive set of royal roads, and I'll come back to this in a second, which is really a masterpiece. It's based on earlier ones that were established by the Assyrians, but they have this system of royal roads that cover the whole empire all the way down into Egypt. And not only are these roads so organized that they can reach the entirety of the empire, we also have the records of everybody who traveled along those who left from one of the Persian cities. So these are royal roads, they're controlled by the king. And so to travel along them, you actually had to have permission. You had a little document that you took with you. And if you were going from, say, Persepolis to Jerusalem, it knew exactly how many days it should take. You had to stop at the stopping houses and they would feed you. So you had a certain number of rations to use up. And their administrative structure was so complex that we actually have the copies of these left in the archives at Persepolis, which is the capital. And so on the Oriental Institute website at Chicago, if you're interested in this, you can go in and see all of these, the administrative tablets. Some of these include these texts for who can travel on the royal roads. There's tax receipts, there's ration receipts, all sorts of things. Some of them are in Aramaic, some of them are in Elamite cuneiform, and we have, I think, one in Old Persian. But even in the heartland of the Persian Empire, they didn't keep the records in Persian because not very many people could read them. So the major center is the city of Persepolis, which is was a major, major complex that underwent several periods of rebuilding. And I was saying to Honey as we started, before I die, this is the one place I want to go. I have always wanted to go to Persepolis. It doesn't matter how many times I look at the pictures, I'm always absolutely in awe of this massive complex. And you see it here. This complex is added to by various kings from the time of Darius, and is really a masterpiece of propaganda and power. It really shows the strength of them. It shows their connection to their whole empire. And we have lots of pieces of it that when put together show a connected empire that stretches all over. And so here, for example, you see the Palace of Darius. The stairways to the audience hall, which is known as the Apadana, are decorated with a series of images of courtiers, and you can just see them down here. Images of power and images of everybody in the empire bringing offerings to the Persian king. So these are supposed to be Lydians. So each of the groups that are portrayed on the Apadana reliefs actually are a different ethnic group that lived under the Persian empire. And we see them depicted here on this great scene of power. Now, religiously, they come in with a completely different faith from anything that's going on in the Middle East at this point. In later periods, we call it Zoroastrianism. In this period, it seems to be very much still in development. And so scholars have argued about whether we call it Zoroastrianism or Mazdaism, because as an earlier form of this. It certainly has most of the aspects that we'll see in later Zoroastrianism, and is based around one major god named Ahura Mazda, but it is a religion of duality. So good over evil, light over dark, and has a connection to the natural elements like fire and water. And we see that reflected in the minor gods. So it is a completely different faith. But what's interesting is, unlike faiths like later Christianity, for example, it doesn't proselytize. It is a religion that is very much kept in the Persian realm. So we see the conquering. I'm not going to go through all of this because I have two other empires to cover, but I put this up so you can see how things develop. The Egypt is conquered in 525. And then we go through with Darius I. We have the building of Persepolis. We get major monuments appearing. But we also start to see the interactions with Greece. So the Battle of Marathon is in 490. And King Darius is a fascinating figure because there's a whole romantic story about whether he should or should not be king. It's a very complicated story about whether he was pretending to be somebody else. But the Behistun inscription, which I showed you right at the very beginning, that key inscription, is again a statement of his power. And he says, Ahura Mazda has granted unto me this empire. He brought me help until I gained this empire. By the grace of Ahura Mazda, do I hold this empire. He is, in that inscription, showing his conquering over people who try to rebel against him. He's justifying his rule. He goes on to say, Ahura Mazda brought me help and all the other gods, all that there are, because I was not wicked, nor was I a liar, nor was I a tyrant, neither I or any of my family. I have ruled according to righteousness, neither to the weak nor to the powerful did I do wrong. And part of this inscription is him justifying his rule, because, as I say, there's a complicated story about whether he actually should be king. But part of this is about the propaganda of showing they have the right to rule. And I show you this because this is from another palace. This is from the palace of Susa, but the bricks are still have their original color. So I wanted to show you just how magnificent these palaces would have been in their original context. By the 460s, well, even by the 480s, we start to see that this huge empire has started to crack a little bit. It's gotten too big. We see rebellion in a number of places. There's then, of course, the war again with the Greeks at Thermopylae and Salamis. And in 465, Xerxes is murdered, not until he is added to the palace at Persepolis. And they add through using all sorts of Near Eastern motifs. Here we have the winged bulls or the lamassus, which are a very old Assyrian image. But after Xerxes I, what we start to get is a slowing down of the strength of this empire. But for the first 150 years, it's extremely strong. And they managed to keep it together as an empire for another 300 years, or another 100 years. Now, my students know I always mock Alexander the Great. I call him Alexander the Mediocre. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about this. But of course, in 330, Alexander the Great marches down through here and takes control of everything that was the Persian Empire. It brings Persia to a halt, but it brings us to a couple of problems. So we get, here's Alexander without his nose, we get a now we have a problem in the scholarship that I want to introduce you to, which is the question of whether we can really use the term Hellenism after this point. So starting with Alexander the Great, who gets to Persepolis, burns it to the ground. The last king of Persia disappears. So I thought I had a slide with that, but the last king of Persia disappears. He's killed in 330. And Alexander the Great continues his march towards India. On his way back, he dies. He dies very young. And his empire, which had been the Persian Empire, is divided up amongst all his generals. So when it's divided up amongst all his generals, Western historians really hang their hats on this, and they say that's the start of something called the Hellenistic period. Now, here's my problem as a Near Eastern scholar with the concept of the Hellenistic period. Hellenistic means all about Greek, right? But there were people there, and there were cultures there. And so Hellenistic sort of privileges the Greek and takes away from what was there, and then also what develops when the Greek comes together with particularly the Persian. And so I never loved the term Hellenism, because it makes it sound like it was a bunch of barbarians who, of course, didn't know anything, but thank God the Greeks arrived. And I say this as a Greek, right? So it's a Western conceit that I think has played a part in how little we know about the pre-Islamic period in this part of the world. We do have the Hellenistic kingdoms. They start in about 320. The last one dies out in 60 in Egypt, but the ones in the Middle East die out a lot earlier than that. And I'm going to show you why. So starting in the 3rd century BCE, we get the arrival of a group who we can call our second, and I definitely put this in quotes, Persian Empire. Now, we call them Persians because the Greeks and the Romans call them Persians, because the Greeks and the Romans don't know any better, and they think all Persians are the same. This is a very different group of people. They probably come from Central Asia. We know even less about them than we knew about the first Persians. When they're being specific about them, the Romans call them Parthians, because they think they come from the region of Parthava. And if I go back here, so they think they come from this region here. We're not entirely sure where they originate, probably Central Asia. And they're more properly known as the Arsacids, because the first king was known as Arsaces. Surprising, right? But if you look at the dates for this empire, this is a 500-year-long empire. It's an absolutely astounding group of people who leave us absolutely nothing in writing. So again, we have this huge problem in trying to understand them, because they simply didn't write things down. So what do we know about them? Well, I've got my friend King Senatruk here to help us talk about this. We have some inscriptions. Most of them are in variations of Aramaic. We have some reliefs. We have a few palaces. We have some fire temples, which are the temples associated with Zoroastrianism. We know almost nothing about their religious beliefs beyond that. We think they're Zoroastrian, but it's a complicated problem. Lots of coins. They liked Greek imagery on their coins, but then often put the inscriptions in debased Aramaic. Some cities, artifacts spelt wrong, sorry about that. Small artifacts. The Roman and later Byzantine writers write about them. Later Islamic writers write about them, most notably Tabari, and they must have had access to things we've now lost. And then later we also have the Avesta, which is the set of holy texts, but those are not written down until the Sasanian period. So what we actually have is a real problem in how to define them, because these guys were like chameleons. This was an empire almost entirely based on trade and trade routes. And they absorbed everything they came into contact with, and we get the creation of new imagery and new ideas that vary from city to city. So when we're studying the Parthians, we actually have to go from city to city and think about regionality and how Persian concepts met with indigenous concepts, which met with Greek or Roman concepts. So for example, King Sanatruk here is from a city called Hatra in northern Iraq. And what we see here is a combination of Near Eastern images, but things that are also specifically, we think, Parthian, like the tunic and the pants and the curly hair. And whenever the Romans had to depict a Parthian, they would put them in pants and a tunic because they were very shocked that they wore pants. It really upset the Romans that the Parthians wore pants. But it's because the Parthians were amazing horsemen. And we still have modern concepts that go back to the Parthians that come down to us. So for example, if you have ever read Victorian era poetry where somebody is in love and they get a Parthian shot, this is the ability to shoot somebody while riding a horse and shooting backwards. So a Parthian shot in love poetry is something you never see coming, right? So we have this imagery that carries down to us right from this period. So it's very difficult to define them the way I could the first one. So in fact, instead I'm gonna show you a couple of case studies just so you get a sense of how much variety there is. This is one of the most famous and important sites. This is a site called Nisa, which is in modern Turkmenistan, which was excavated by an Italian team. It's founded about 150. Here is just a view of it, but what I want you to see is some of the finds. So here is the outline of the city. And what you find is a very Greek style city, very organized, nicely put together. And then a combination of artifacts that show just how much of a composite culture this was. So this is a kind of art called stucco, which we find throughout this period and the next Persian Empire. This is a Persian technique. We have a Hellenistic style soldier over here. We have a, actually I'll come back to that in a second. We have a depiction of the Venus de Milo next to a Persian goddess or a local goddess who's got a Medusa on her chest. And this is an absolutely fascinating piece. This is a drinking vessel with a Persian animal on the bottom, but a Greek frieze at the top. And so we know that the Persians were, sorry, the Parthians were Philhellenes. They were very fond of Greek culture, but they were also fond of Persian culture. And so we get this interesting amalgam of ideas that appear in each of the cities. So that is at Nisa. Here we have another leader with a very specific Persian hat from the city of Hatra, and then a type of architecture, which is known from the Persian world, which is called Iwan architecture, which are these big barrel vaults leading into a hall. Now, unfortunately, Hatra did not do very well in either the Gulf War or under ISIS, and we've lost a lot of material from there, including many of these beautiful statues. But the material from here is really important for understanding how they brought these cultural norms and combined them as they moved forward. They also encountered a number of cities, local leaders, and many of these local leaders were allowed to carry on and do their own thing as long as they paid attention. This is one of my favorites. This is from the far southeast of Turkey. It's a site called Nimrud Dağ. And all of the pictures that you see for this are ones I took myself when we visited there. It's high, high up in a mountain. I thought I was going to die on the drive up there. And this big thing you're looking at is actually a grave tumulus, probably for the king, maybe for his daughter. We don't know who's inside of it because the whole thing is made of pebbles. So archaeologists can't get in there. It's probably the cleverest ancient monument I've ever encountered. There's just no way in. The only way you could find out what's inside is to destroy it. It's way high up on the mountains. It's a huge, huge grave complex. There's a view. There's the Euphrates down below and then the mountains in the distance. And it's surrounded by these huge statues. The heads of the statues are the same height as me, and I'm about 5 feet tall. So absolutely enormous statues. And what's really fascinating about these statues is this particular leader, who's caught between the early arrival of the Romans and the Parthians, decides to play both sides up against the middle. And so he claims he is both the descendant of Hercules, and he is the descendant of the gods, the Zoroastrian gods. And so he puts pictures up that appeal to both. And he puts up the stories of his ancestry on either side. And these circle the monument. So very clever, and part of this cultural world that's going on in the Parthian period, where as long as you say and do the right things, you can continue to basically do whatever you want. And then a final case study, and then I'll move on to my last empire, is the site of Dura Europus, which is on the Euphrates. Dura too has not survived, this time not survived ice as well. Dura was a small town that was taken over by the Greeks on their way through. And they created a nice plan here. So we have a nice Hellenistic city. And then the Parthians take it over, and then the Romans take it over, and then the Parthians take it over, and they all just live with each other because it's a trading center. Now, Dura Europus was very well hidden in the desert, and so was discovered in the early part of the First World War. And because nobody had been there since it was abandoned in the 200s, it was full of things we'd never seen before. And absolutely one of the most important sites for understanding the Parthian culture. But in order to illustrate this, I'm actually going to show you one of the world's earliest synagogues. And Dura Europus had one of the earliest, has the earliest church and one of the earliest synagogues. And the walls of the synagogues are decorated with biblical stories. And in doing so, they have drawn on Parthian art to try and create their story. So if we were in class, I would make somebody guess what this is. But this is, in fact, the story of Queen Esther and King Mordecai. You can see, even though this is an old story, he's dressed like a Parthian. We have people dressed like Romans. We've got Parthian outfits. And what we're seeing is this amalgam of culture in a place where we wouldn't expect to see it. And I can, if people have questions about that, I can talk about that more in the question period. So the Parthians kind of peter out near the end. Partly this was from exhaustion from fighting with the Romans. They started to lose ground, and then they lost all of their ground to the last of these Persian empires, which is a group that does come from Persia itself, from Iran, from Fars province. And this is a group who are known as the Sasanians. They're also known as the Sasanids. So you'll see both. And they are a group that is, they rule from 226 CE to 641. They take over everything that the Parthians had controlled. And they're an interesting group because as we watch early Christianity in the West and the Roman Empire changing, we see the same things happening with this group, but in their own, under their own terms. So religion becomes a very much a unifying factor, and we see them espousing an idea of divine right. So Ahura Mazda gives them the right to rule. It's a much more rigid and formal empire than we've seen before. It builds on earlier concepts of power and lineage. So I'll show you some images of this, but they definitely connect themselves to the first Persians. It's a very much a multicultural empire, and their emperor, the king, is known as the King of Kings, the Shah and Shah. And so we get a much more formal group that comes out of this part of Iran. Now, here we do suddenly start to understand more about the religion. We have almost nothing from the Parthian period. We don't know what they were doing. And we only partially understand the religion in the first Persian Empire. By the end of the Sasanian Empire, they will actually write down their religious texts. We lose most of them in the mostly the Mongol invasions later on, but we have more of a sense of the religion, and it's much firmer. Now we understand it as a dualistic religion. We understand the sort of lineage of it with the prophets or Zoroaster. We understand the argument between light and dark, Ahura Mazda as good and Angra Mainyu as bad. We have fire sanctuaries that appear all over the Sasanian world. We have them in Armenia, for example. We start to see minor gods who have always been there, but we now see them a little bit better. And Mithras is one who the Romans love, and they pick him up and take him back and create their own religion based on this, which is a whole other subject for another day. And we start to get a sense of the priests and the construction of the religion. The language is spoken. So we have a form of Persian, a Middle Persian. We're still seeing Aramaic as a major language. The Jewish community has a variation of Aramaic called Babylonian Aramaic. The Christians are still speaking Aramaic, but this is now morphed into later Syriac. And there is still a little bit of Greek floating around the further, especially the further west you go. So it's still a very complex empire. And I also should add Armenian, because they control parts of Armenia as well. So again, same problem. We do not have written sources. We have inscriptions, we have reliefs, just checking the time here. We have a few palaces, we have lots more fire temples, lots of coins and seals, like as you can see here, small artifacts, still spelt wrong, Roman Byzantine writers, later Islamic writers, and now the chunks of the Avesta that survive. And I just show you this. This is an official. And you can see his name has one of the king's names in it, Shapur. He's the Vedin Shapur. And you can see that he's got his inscriptions written in a Middle Persian, in Middle Persian. So here is the extent of the Sasanian Empire. So again, really enormous empire for 400 years until it falls to the Islamic invasions. At different points, they invade into Roman territories and hold it, not often for very long, but we do have, in archaeological terms, evidence for destruction all the way through here when they come through. At one point, they get to Jerusalem and steal the relic of the true cross and take it all the way back to Mesopotamia, which causes quite an uproar back over here, as you can imagine. And they leave for us very specific imagery that gives us a sense of a very different kind of power. So here, for example, is King Ardashir. And I show you this because here is Ardashir, and he is receiving the ring of power from Ahura Mazda. Before, we had this kind of imagery for the first Persians, but it was smaller, it was more compact. Now it's larger than life, it's on rock faces, and they always choose rock faces that have connections to where the first Persians had put up their imagery. So very deliberate attempts to create lineage and to create power. Whether there was real lineage, we have no idea. but they certainly use the imagery to create it. And there's just another map for you. So one of the, actually, let me just go back here because I actually want to show you, you can just see under their feet, people being crushed, right? This is not imagery we see with either of the first two empires. I wanted to show you a couple of images here, which make this even a little more, bring this a little more home. So this is at a site called Naqsh-e Rustam, which was very significant to the Achaemenids. And here we have Shapur the First, and he's got two people doing things. Well, what he has here are two Romans. This is Philip the Arab, who is making a treaty with him. And this is Valerian, who was captured by Shapur the First and died in captivity. So it's an image of conquest over the Romans that we're seeing depicted at a place that was sacred to the first Persians. And you can see there it is, and there is the tomb of Darius the First, right? So they're very careful to put these things in proximity. So here he is, and then this is a later Sasanian relief as well. And this is at another site called Bishapur. And again, this time it gets even better because here's Philip the Arab, here's Valerian in chains, and here underneath is Gordian the Third, who died en route to Ctesiphon. So really these sort of images of conquest. And you can see here in the imagery, these are throwbacks to the kind of imagery known from the Apadana at Persepolis. We have soldiers and courtiers, and there's dominance over these other cultures. It's not quite as warm and fuzzy a picture as we got from the first Persians. This is a very important relief because we have a very brief period where they persecute Christians, Jews, and other religious groups. And they're because of this guy who was a priest. This is one of the few times we see this. And this is also what the only inscription by a non-royal. And he was a priest named Gradir. This is just a combat. But we also see that there are periods where other groups are persecuted by this group. And again, that's not something that would have happened under the first two. And so just to finish off, let me show you their capital city. This was, they had, of course, capitals in Iran and further east. But the capital we know the most about is a place called Seleucia Ctesiphon. Seleucia was a Hellenistic city on this side of the Tigris, and Ctesiphon was the Parthian city over here. And then they established their own city called Vet Ardashir here. And so we get a major complex growing around the Tigris River. Now the route of the Tigris has changed, so it's looks a little different today. But it was it was called the Dual Cities and was indicative of all three cultures that had lived in this region. Now, Near Eastern cities in this period were often circular cities. And later when the Arabs established Baghdad, it will also be a circular city, which is why that is a big circle. So in the remains from this, again, we see this amalgam of cultures, which is really interesting in telling us how multicultural this was. So we've got Persian figures, Hellenistic figures, and this is one of my very, very favorite pieces. It's a Greek style goddess, but she's got Parthian or Sasanian hair. And my grad student actually explained to me that the eyes are very common in Sasanian art, these kind of almond eyes. Lots of stucco decoration, and here we have one with Persian on it, things like animals. And again, this amalgamation, because here's a Greek symbol in a Parthian, a Sasanian place. Most famous structure is the Great Palace at Ctesiphon. It's known as the Takhisra. I don't know what state it's in after the Gulf War. It's still standing. More of it was standing even in the 1920s, but this is a major palace with, again, that same kind of architectural technique. And interestingly, one of our only churches from this period, which existed under the Sasanians and the Catholicos, which was the name of the equivalent of the patriarch or the pope in the East, was often an advisor to the Sasanian king. So we know there were major religious councils. We know where their major church was. And what's interesting about the church is it mimics Sasanian architecture. So very much the Christians and the Jews who were living under the Sasanians, except in periods of persecution, were in fact quite integral to the running of the empire. So I'll finish off with just two more quick slides, just to talk a little bit about the end of the Sasanian Empire. So the Sasanian Empire came to an end after many, many years of fighting with the late Romans or the Byzantines. Both empires were tired. And then out of Arabia arose the Arabs and the arrival of Islam. Neither empire could stand in the face of this new group that had come out of the Arabian Peninsula. They were young, they were vibrant, they were all on horseback, and these empires were tired. The Roman Empire sort of sucks back into what we think of as Turkey today, abandons everything to the Arabs, and the Arab Muslims move into Iran, where they defeat the Sasanians, and the last remnants of the Sasanian royal family actually go into exile in China. But the stories associated with this empire live on, and so we get stories from the Sasanian world carried on into Islamic writings much later. So the Shahnameh, the Book of Kings by Ferdowsi in the 14th century. And so here you have two manuscripts of it, which recounts some of the stories associated with this period. And the effect of Iranian art on modern Iranian writers and painters can't be underestimated. And so just to end, I draw your attention to Marjane Satrapi's book, Persepolis, which is absolutely wonderful about a girl growing up in Iran. But one of the things when I read it, I was struck by was how much of the art in it harkens back to earlier periods of Iranian history, quite deliberately. And I really think that we don't have a great grasp in the West of how important these three Persian empires were to the continuity and movement of cultures in the Middle East throughout this period. Thank you very much.